because this one's about B.F. Skinner and how he espoused freedom and dignity and kindness, love, compassion, and positivity. On behalf of the B.F. Skinner Institute and Dr. Julie Vargas, the goal of this video is to make sure that the public and the world understands B.F. Skinner's vision of positive strategies, positive reinforcement, that he did believe in freedom and dignity, and that the individual should not feel controlled. Freedom's important. So we're gonna call you Sweet Tea Freedom. Sweet Freedom Tea, what do you think, man?
Freedom Tea, I like it, free tea.
Free tea, all right. All right, Sweet Freedom Tea, let's do this, man. Point number one by B.F. Skinner in this 1972 interview. What I really love is how he specifically speaks about the individual should feel free from tyrants and people that are abusive with power and coercion. So people that force you to do things through negative reinforcement, unpleasant, undesirable consequences. Dr. Skinner uncovered these principles and described how people should be free of that. Dr. Skinner wanted people to be free of punitive consequences.
Just how free is man?
Well, of course, it depends on what you mean by freedom. I think traditionally, the struggle for freedom has been concerned with freeing men from what we call aversive events, punitive events, annoying events, discomfort, and that kind of thing. And I'm all for that. I wouldn't change it. I would not deprive man of that kind of freedom. I think he could do a very much better job, however, in living a day in his life free of threatening, coercive, punitive control. That was fine. And I think when you have to free the individual from despots, tyrants, people who control through punitive methods, the best way is to build up the individual, to convince him that he can be free, that the power derives from him, which is being used against him, and so on. I'm all for that. I'm all for building the individual up. But what has happened is that the control has therefore been branded as wrong, because it is something we want to escape from. We don't recognize the fact that we are also controlled when we do what we want to do, when we feel free.
Okay, Sweet Freedom Tea, point number two that Dr. B.F. Skinner points out when he's asked this question, he's calling it reinforcement as a change agent.
You've talked about the power of reinforcement as a change agent.
Yes. Well, reinforcement is a thing that I've investigated myself. It's not the only thing in the world, but it is extremely powerful, and that has not really been recognized. Positive.
So in this part here, Dr. B.F. Skinner makes it really clear how positive reinforcement should be the primary go-to.
Positive reinforcement, or what people call rewards, that is an extremely powerful technique, and we've only discovered the power fairly recently, strangely enough. We tend to control people through aversive control, punishing people for misbehaving or threatening them until they behave the ways we want them to behave and so on. But you can, with positive techniques, get better effects, and effects that we all like, because we feel free when we are controlled through positive reinforcement. We don't feel free when we are being coerced or threatened with punishment.
Okay, point three. I love Dr. B.F. Skinner's response to this, where the interviewer says that people are afraid of the idea that their behavior is controlled by the environment. And his response is pretty cool, because it's very accurate, that many people take credit as though they did something internally, that it was an agency within their mind, when things go really well and it's a great outcome. But whenever something turns out to be a poor outcome, he points out that people readily blame the environment. I love that one.
We have taken unto ourselves credit for what we do, and we don't like to have the environment get the credit. However, we are perfectly willing to have the environment get the blame. That's the most interesting thing. If a juvenile delinquent comes from a poor background, he is the first one to say, oh, look, I came from a very bad background. That's why I committed a crime. And we're likely to say, well, you're right about that. But if a child comes from a good environment and creates a work of art, we don't want him to say, that's because of the environment. We want that to say, because of you. That was you who did that, you see. Well, it cuts both ways. And you have it either one way. Either the individual is responsible for what he does by way of achievements, and for what he does by way of bad behavior, in which case we punish and commend, or it is due to the environment, in which case we recognize the role of the environment. It doesn't mean that the individual has not done some wonderful things he has. He still has a piece of music or a work of art or scientific discovery which has been made and produced, and is produced as a result of an individual behaving. But where the credit goes is a thing that worries people.
Point number four. The interviewer asked Dr. Skinner, how can people protect themselves against the control of the powerful science of behavior analysis so they don't feel controlled? I love his response here, where he explains that, in his own language, once you understand the behavioral contingencies that your behavior is influenced by, such as operant conditioning or classical conditioning, once you understand it, you're less likely to be manipulated or exploited in some kind of inappropriate way to do things that are not good for you or for culture itself.
Well, you can see what's being done, and you'd be aware of the techniques that are being used, and of course you can use these techniques yourself. Many books have been published in the field of behavior modification on how to control one's own behavior. How do you find the environment in which you are most likely to behave well and achieve and to do a creative in achieving things? And you can do that, and I think people ought to be taught how to do it. We no longer teach very much by way of ethical self-management or intellectual self-management. But we could, and we'll again, I'm sure.
Okay, point five from the 1977 interview. I love this. Dr. B.F. Skinner speaks about the need to make sure that positive behavior is salient, that it's conspicuous, that it's very clear when someone's making progress. Kind of like just how that Fitbit that you use for exercising, initially when you looked at it and it was salient to you, the number of steps that you took, it was motivating. So the saliency and it being conspicuous, your own behavior, can be a motivator in itself.
So what we do is to make the reinforcements very conspicuous. This is done by the token economy. You take a ward in a hospital, these people are sitting around doing nothing. Only time they get any attention is when they cause trouble. It's a very poor situation, but you can rearrange that so that they get tokens for doing things, making their beds, getting dressed, and so on. And they can use the tokens to buy extra dessert at mealtime and things of that kind. And that makes their lives very different. And it's a good example of designing a reinforcer which has to be used in a particularly conspicuous way.
Also in this clip, he says a way to make behavior conspicuous and salient is to use token systems. So basically, not to patronize someone, like here you get a point and a sticker. Money is a token reinforcer, so it can be exchanged for things that are generalizable. But what I love is that he speaks about the end result and the end goal of behavior analysis is for the operantly conditioned behavior to contact the natural rewards in society. So you fade out the tokens, and then later people start to enjoy work that they do, they feel meaning and dignity, people start to make friends, they find a spouse, and they feel good about the purpose in their life.
Now, I wouldn't recommend that you go around reinforcing people with tokens all the time, although money is nothing but a token. We use it to reinforce people for working for us. But the normal natural reinforcers in daily life work on the same principle. And if you were a painter, for example, you like what you put paint on the canvas and you're reinforced by the result, so you go and put more paint on. If you're a musician, you like to make music, you sit down and make music, and music is reinforcing to you. It's a natural consequence, where the token is one that someone has cooked up for practical purposes.
All right, point number six. He's asked a question and he responds about programmed instruction. What I love about this is he points out the fact that instruction should be more of a free operant, where people can respond at their own pace and receive frequent, abundant amounts of reinforcement. And by moving at their own pace, they can learn at a more rapid rate, which I love that, as opposed to, you know, there are some kids out there that are in classrooms and they're really super smart kids with a very high IQ, and they're not permitted to move at a more rapid rate, therefore they find themselves getting in trouble because they create problems just because they're bored.
And the whole point of programming is, it's often misunderstood. Programmed instruction, of course, is now recognized, and when it was first introduced, it was an effort to break into the system where all students have to move at the same pace. You allow the individual to go at his own pace. It's terribly important, because holding people in line is very wasteful of their time and the time of everyone.
Another point about programmed instruction is that, if you'll note in this clip, he points out the importance of errorless learning. that you can design instruction to minimize errors and make sure that the trainee or the student recognizes frequent reinforcement through lots of successes and very few to no errors.
But not only does programming do that, it designs material in such a way that the student is almost always right, rather than being almost always wrong, as in the ordinary way. And this means that you get an interest in what you're doing, and you stick with it and go on with it, and you don't need to force yourself to work, and yet you are making progress, because every step you take makes it possible to take another step, which is more complicated and moves into more difficult material.
Okay, on point 7, it's similar to a previous point, but she asked the question of Dr. B.F. Skinner, do we face danger as a human species as a result of someone having such a powerful technology such as operant conditioning? I really love Dr. Skinner's answer, where he explains that any powerful science can clearly do harm if in the hands of the wrong people. A point that he makes very clear here that I love is that the best way to prevent someone from being abused or being abused yourself, like he said earlier, is to understand the science so that way you know it's happening to you.
Can it?
Any science has its dangers. Think of the munitions industry, what they've done. Think of what has been done with atomic physics. And if the wrong people get control of behavioral techniques exclusively, we would be in very serious trouble. The best way to have that happen would be to suppress these techniques, because they won't be suppressed forever and other people will get them. I try to make these things as clear to everybody as possible. The best way to make sure that you're not going to be abused by a controller is to understand all of the possible techniques of control so you can see what's going on. People are not aware of how they're being controlled.
Okay, Sweet Freedom T, point 8. Dr. Skinner points out a specific example of when a powerful technology such as behavior analysis may be in the wrong hands. It can exploit people, such as gambling. So the contingencies of reinforcement that one may be under in a slot machine may be considered a variable ratio or a random ratio schedule, where before the person realizes it, they're putting in more money than they're receiving in payouts. And these small, frequent, immediate amounts of reinforcement with the potential to hit a large jackpot is very powerful, and it can actually do a lot of damage to people socially, culturally. It can actually damage relationships. Many divorces have occurred over gambling.
And this is a good example of making use of the fact that the individual doesn't know how he's being controlled when he is not only offered lottery tickets, but subject to television and other advertising and reports of how much people have won and so on. This is all done to get people to throw away their money because the odds are very bad on those things. They're not good gambling at all. And this is the way in which the state collects. Well, I think that is a misuse of a kind of control which can be misused because people don't understand. I should think everybody in a school ought to be told how they can be taken by anybody who uses those particular contingencies of reinforcement on them.
Okay, and the last but not least, point number 9. Skinner's asked the question, can these behavior analytic principles be transferred and generalized to a large complex system or culture such as the United States? I love his response. He speaks about some of the social problems that can occur in very congregate, congested urban settings such as cities. And in certain terms, he speaks about the idea that it's a good movement for folks to slowly decentralize into smaller communities, because if there are too many people in one setting with the wrong contingencies at play, there are too many strangers where people don't know each other and don't have face-to-face interaction. So he points out how decentralization of large cities can result in fewer social problems because people know each other. And he also speaks about the idea that small communities kind of police themselves among the neighbors instead of requiring external enforced coercion through the police.
Well, I think the United States is going to see a return to small communities. People are leaving cities now and going back to smaller towns. Whether or not those small communities are well designed is another matter. I think it could be done. I think we should make every effort to make a small town a highly reinforcing place to live, rather than at the present time the kind of place that sends us, that's more interesting, imagine, to people off to a city.
Cities like Boston, New York, Milwaukee face so many social problems. Can what's being learned in utopian communities be transferred to such large cities?
It'd be very difficult. That's one of the reasons why I think everything should be done to keep big cities from becoming big and staying big. The problem, you know, is worse in the third world. The biggest, the most rapid rise in cities now is in the third world. These high-rise buildings go up, and people flock in from all over looking for jobs which they don't find. It creates a terrible social problem. Now, you could do a great deal in this country, certainly, to get people to stay in a much better environment in smaller communities if you could make them more interesting. One thing you could do, for example, would be to make sure that public television gets to every set in the continental United States. With a single satellite would do that. And then the young man in my position who had to leave a small town to hear any good music or see theaters and so on could see that all right at home, and a young woman too. And the young people who are the ones who ought to be staying in these communities and building them up and making them interesting places tend to get away now because they can't stand the culture of a small town. But that can be changed. And the small face-to-face community where you don't delegate control to police or so on is much better for everyone than a city where you are all strangers to each other, really. And I feel it's a great chance to build up the small community again, not necessarily along the lines of a Walden II, but still by using behavioral engineering to work out ways in which a life in such a community can be more satisfying.
Myself and Dr. Julie Vargas and the B.F. Skinner Institute really hope that the messages that you get out of this dispel some of the myths that Dr. Skinner was all about punishment, coercion, organisms such as rats and pigeons. These operant conditioning principles that B.F. Skinner uncovered can have great utility in getting rid of social problems and ameliorating problems in cities and helping countries and allowing people to feel free and have dignity. This guy had it figured out since 1940 and through 1970 and through many years beyond. So I want to thank Dr. B.F. Skinner and thank you, Dr. Julie Vargas, for pointing me in the right direction as my mentor.